Our next presenter is Sander van der Burg, who's been a long, long time contributor to Nix. He's definitely been around for, I don't know, 7 years, 8 years maybe. 8 years, actually. And before the talk, I sat down with him and thought about, okay, what are the things that you contributed to Nix and that we should mention? And it quickly became apparent that it would be silly to try and mention all of it. It's just too much. There is, I think, the Android environment, development environment, for instance, is one of his contributions, and there are numerous others. Pardon? Oh, sorry. And and today he'll tell us about this Nix system, which has also been around for a long time, really. And I hear it's even going to include a live demonstration, so let's keep our fingers crossed. Okay, have fun.
That's it.
Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, so this talk will be about deploying microservices with Disnix, and in this talk I actually try to cover both aspects, and I hope you guys feel excited by it. So, recently I discovered this article saying why 2015 will be the year of microservices. So in less than 2 months, 2015 will be over, so then we can reflect on how well microservices have conquered the world. There are even books available at about microservices. I must admit, I haven't read them, so don't ask me about them, but they might be useful. But microservice architectures, what are they? So this is some definition I found online on Martin Fowler's website, and he, I must admit, this is quite a long explanation. But it has some interesting keywords inside it. For example, we have processes that communicate with lightweight mechanisms. They typically use HTTP. These services are built around business capabilities. They're independently deployable by fully automated deployment solutions. We can use many different programming languages and data storage technologies to implement them, and that's all great. However, 8 years ago, I was doing research, and this is a paper I read about service-oriented computing and service-oriented architectures. And if you read the description there, you find something like this. Services are autonomous, platform-independent, they can be loosely coupled. They also seem to be built around business processes. They also support network availability and things like that. So I think this definition has quite an overlap with microservices. And 10 years before this paper was written, there was also this book about component software. This book states that a component is a unit of composition. It has contractually specified interfaces and explicit context dependencies only. And of course, components can be deployed independently and they're subject to composition by third parties. So, in my opinion, microservices aren't really a new revolution, but there's something good in it, and that is dividing your big monolithic software system into components. That actually is beneficial. And also to make these components network transparent, that's also a nice addition. So, when I discover something new, I always try to implement some kind of example to figure out in what way it could benefit me. So I've decided to implement an example system to see how well microservices could benefit me. But my brain is a bit empty, so I couldn't think of a good example. So I've decided to implement something stupid, which I call a staff tracker. And that's basically a software system that I can use to maintain a collection of staff members. I can maintain their room numbers. And I can use these room numbers, for example, determine what their zip code is. And I can use the zip code, for example, to determine in what street and city they are. So that's a nice way to violate their privacies, I think. And also, because I want to discover how well microservices work, I've decided to divide this system into processes communicating through lightweight network protocols. So I ended up designing an architecture like this. So basically what I need is I need to maintain three collections of data. I need to maintain rooms, I need to maintain staff members, and I need to maintain zip codes. So I've decided to implement a microservice with an HTTP interface that provides read, update, delete, and create access to these records. Also, I've decided to develop a web application front end. I've also decided to separate that into a separate process that's isolated from the web services that work with the data. Also, I've decided to divide the data over three databases instead of storing it into one single database. And also, I'm using an Nginx proxy in front of the web application because I find it more reliable and more efficient. So, there are actually some pros in designing a system like that. And on Martin Fowler's website, I found three interesting criteria that he described. Like, if you design a system like that, you have strong module boundaries. So that means I can, for example, build development teams around each service. Somebody can implement the web application, some other team can implement the service providing me access to the staff members, and so on. Also, by having an architecture like this, I support independent deployment. So for example, if the web application blows up for whatever reason, the service that provides access to the data records, for example, shouldn't crash. It's a separate process. And also, if we support independent deployment, then that also typically means we have fewer dependencies. So typically, these modules are much easier to deploy. And also in an architecture like this, we have something called technology diversity. So it doesn't really matter what technology I use to implement it. I can use JavaScript to implement one microservice, and I can use Python for another service. I can choose whatever database I want, as long as I just communicate through HTTP. It doesn't really matter. There are also some cons in designing an architecture like this. I also took these cons from Martin Fowler's website, and one con is distribution. So there's always a network link involved for communication between components. And these network links could be quite slow and also subject to failure. So that means if something fails, also your system as a whole might fail for whatever reason. Also, eventual consistency is a problem. So I've decided to separate the data into three separate databases. But these databases are related to each other in some way. And that means, how can I ensure that these relations remain consistent? That's quite difficult. But I think probably the biggest con is operational complexity. And that means, for example, if we deploy a system like this that consists of eight components, we might want to deploy all these eight components to one machine, but we could also deploy them to individual machines for performance reasons. That means, in worst case, I need to maintain eight machines. Also, I can choose any technology I want, but if I would choose many technologies, that also means there are many ways to build my services from source code. And also, if I would use multiple operating systems, then also my deployment procedure would be affected by it. So that turns deployment process typically into a nightmare. And also, there are many other things that we have to take care of. For example, if we upgrade the system, how can we do it frequently? How can we ensure that we don't break anything? How can we ensure that, for example, that if we upgrade, that the downtime is minimized? And also, if we regret doing a particular upgrade, we might also want to roll back to an old configuration. So these are all issues you have to cope with in maintaining and upgrading a microservice or architecture. But luckily, there's the Nix project providing us interesting deployment tools. And basically, what we do in the Nix project, but that's something you probably already know, is we support automated deployment using declarative specifications. And besides having an automated deployment solution, we also, in the Nix project, support a number of interesting properties, like Nix tools are generic. They're not bound to any programming language or component technology. We can use it for any language, Java, Haskell, Node.js, Python, and so on. Doesn't really matter. Also, tools in the Nix project support reproducible deployment. That's also a nice feature. I produce a configuration on my machine. I can easily reproduce the exact same configuration on a different machine if the inputs remain the same. Also, tools in the Nix project have strong reliability guarantees, like dependency completeness, atomic upgrades, and rollbacks. And also, they're quite efficient in the sense that Nix tools try to only execute deployment activities that are required to get the system running. And of course, these tools, you already know them. They're all driven by declarative specifications. And if you run the tool figures out what activities need to be carried out to get the deployment working. So for example, if you write a NixOS specification, it figures out, hey, I have to build a number of packages. I probably have to transfer some packages from one machine to another. And also, I probably need to activate certain services in order to make the system working. You, as an end user, don't have to worry about that. You just write what you want, and the tools deliver what's described in the model. And if you want to do an upgrade, you basically adapt the model and run the tool again, and it figures out what the corresponding update activities are. So, if we deploy this microservice architecture that I just designed, how can we deploy such a system the Nix way? And that's actually where Disnix comes in handy. So Disnix is specifically designed for such a purpose. So in Disnix, you basically write three kinds of models. The first model is the services model that basically describes of what components my system consists and what their dependencies are and how to build them from source code. The other model is the infrastructure model. So we have to deploy to remote machines in the network. So we must know which machines are available and what their properties are. And there is the distribution model, which you can use to map services to machines. So you can basically say, hey, I want service A to go to machine one, and I want service B to go to machine two. And then, yeah, basically just running one single command line instruction suffices to get all the deployment activities executed. So we have to write these declarative specifications in order to deploy something. And that's actually quite similar to packaging ordinary things in Nix. So what you do typically in Nix is, if you want to package something, you write a Nix expression. A Nix expression is typically a function declaration, and the parameters correspond to the dependencies of a service. And in the body, you basically describe how to build a package from the source code and the given dependencies. So in this particular example, I have a package called Hello World Client, which is just a simple client connecting to a server through a TCP connection. And what I basically do here is I provide the locations of the dependencies as make flags. And as a result, the build procedure knows how to find the dependencies and build the package. But in a microservice architecture, we typically rely on network connections. So for example, the Hello World client is supposed to connect to something called a Hello World service by a TCP connection. And that Hello World server component may actually be deployed to a remote machine in the network. If this service is unavailable, that means the Hello World client doesn't work. So there's actually another class of dependencies we have to take into account. So in Disnix, we take two kinds of dependencies into account. One of them, one class is called intra-dependencies. That means the dependencies you need to build and run a package locally. So things like compilers and libraries are considered intra-dependencies. And interdependencies are dependencies on other services that might reside elsewhere in the network. So this is what you typically do in Disnix. So it almost looks like a normal Nix expression, but the inner function that's colored in red is basically a specification of the interdependencies that we need. And we can use this interdependency parameter, for example, to provide the host name and the TCP port of the Hello World server so that the client knows how to reach it. Like ordinary Nix packages, in Nix Each next expression is basically a function definition in which the inputs are basically the dependencies that it needs. But these dependencies need to be composed, so they need to be passed as function arguments to the expression describing it. In this next, you also have to do this. So what you typically find in next packages is some big expression called allPackages.next, in which we have a construct like call packets that provides the dependencies. In this next, you also have to provide the interdependencies for each service that you want to distribute. But there's some extra information that it needs to know. So besides interdependencies, we also need to know stuff about interdependencies. And also, if we want to deploy a system into production, besides getting a package somewhere, we also need to activate the system. And that's actually captured in this model, the services model. So as you can see in the slide, the services model refers to the composition expression shown in the previous slide, but it provides some extra information for each service, allowing it to find its interdependencies and also it provides information to allow it to be activated. And here, for example, the Hello World server. Here I specify, for example, that it runs on port 3000. I also provide a type, and that's actually used for activation. So the wrapper type basically means the package includes a script explaining how to start and stop the service. And the Hello World client, so the depends on parameter basically composes the interdependency. So by passing this as a function argument to the expression shown earlier, the Hello World client knows to which Hello World server component it should connect. Then, of course, besides the services, we also need to know what machines are available and what their properties are. So this is an example infrastructure model. We have three kinds of machines. The first machine is actually a 32-bit Kubuntu Linux machine, and you can use an SSH connection to reach it to execute remote deployment procedures. The second machine is a 64-bit NixOS machine, and to reach it, we actually use a web service instead of SSH. And the third machine is actually a 64-bit Windows 7 machine that we can reach through SSH. And then, of course, the last model is the distribution model. And here, for example, I tell Disnix Hello World server should be deployed to machine test 2. That's the 64-bit NixOS machine. And the client should be deployed to machine test 1. And that's the 32-bit Kubuntu machine. So I can actually show you how this is done in practice. So I have VirtualBox running with these three machines. There's also a Windows machine even. And if I just simply run Disnix on the command line with, wait a sec. So this should suffice to get the Hello World server and client deployed into the network of machines that I've shown to you. So this should take a few seconds. There's actually one problem. I forgot to configure a public SSH host key on the Windows machine. So I cheated by providing a very simple password for that machine. Oh. Something is wrong. Yeah, that's bad. Let me see something. Okay, this is always a risk. No, I discovered something else. The wrong example. I should have used this terminal. I was also planning to show a second demo, and this terminal screen was for the second demo, but this is the right screen for the first demo. So if I run this, As you can see, it's trying to build the system. It's trying to distribute the closures. Now it's asking me for a password, but I can just cheat a bit. Okay, so I basically run this nixenv with the models I've shown you before, and that means we should now have a working system with a Hello World service and a Hello World client. So the 32-bit Kubuntu machine now has a Hello World client application deployed. Actually, the example is pretty silly, but what it does is it's just a telnet connection, and if I say hello, the server responds by saying hello world. But it's just to show I've deployed two components, and they interact with each other with a TCP connection, and both are deployed to different machines. What I also can do is, for example, I can change the distribution model. So this is my initial deployment, but I can also say, hey, let's deploy a second client. So that means the 64-bit NixOS machine has a client installed. And then it's just basically repeating the same command line instruction. It figures out that we have to execute an upgrade. And voila, we're done. So if I connect to this machine, the second NixOS machine, then I'll see there's also a Hello World client deployed. Voila. We can do even more exciting stuff. So there's a third machine in the network, a Windows 7 machine. So let's make use of it. I moved the Hello World server that's currently running on test 2 to test 3, which is the Windows machine. And I try to redeploy the environment. So now you see I run into a problem. And the problem is actually this Nix tries to compile the Hello World service from source on my host machine. But my host machine is a Linux machine, which is unable to build for Windows. Luckily, there's also an option built on targets, allowing me to do the builds on the target machines in the network. And if I do something like this, I basically delegate the builds to the target machines in the network. Well, this should only take a minute, but it's now building the Hello World server on the Windows machine. Yeah, that's a good question. I'll show it to you in a minute. So I redeploy the system. What happens to the Hello World server? That means I moved it, so it was deactivated on machine test 2. So that means the clients have been disconnected. But if I would start the Hello World client again, then it has been reconfigured to connect to the Hello World server that has been deployed to the Windows machine. So it knows where it is. And I can do again hello and see. You see, it just simply responds by. No, so it works like the ordinary Nix package manager. It always keeps the older versions available unless you explicitly garbage collect them. So that means I can also do a rollback, for example, to the previous configuration. I now have to shut these. Well, each time you deploy a new Disnix configuration, it deploys a Disnix profile on the target machines. And as long as you keep these Disnix profiles there, that means the software also remains there. But you can of course use the garbage collector to get rid of them, and then as a result the old versions will be removed. Okay, now I have to do some housekeeping work, so I have to shut down the virtual machines. And I have to do something else, but in a minute I'll tell you what it's about, because this takes a minute, and of course I don't have all the time to I'm now going to run NixOps for some reason, but so, oh, oops. Okay, seems that I doubly deployed the. Well, let's get rid of it. So I create a NixOps deployment named VBox that contains two VirtualBox machines. But in a minute, I'll show you what this is about. This takes a while to deploy, so meanwhile, I'll resume the presentation. So I've basically shown you what Disney is capable of. We can deploy services to any kinds of machine in the network. And this is actually the communication flow that Disney Env tool implements. So it uses some kind of external process that communicates with a protocol wrapper. And the reason why we implemented that is to support multiple network protocols. So by default, it uses SSH, but the second machine, the NixOS 64-bit machine, was actually reachable through a web service only. So this makes Disney protocol agnostic, and that's particularly useful for service-oriented architectures that are supposed to be technology neutral. Also, the Disney service that's responsible for carrying out the remote deployment activities consults two tools, basically, to carry... that's my virtual machine. Oops. So it consults two tools to carry out deployment activities. So for building and distributing services, it uses a Nix package manager. But to get a service-oriented system running, you need to do more. You also need to activate each service and deactivate the obsolete ones. And I implemented a separate tool for that. It's called Disnomia, and that's actually a companion tool. But you can also use that independently. And that takes care, for example, of turning all the services on or off if we must. And it's actually a plugin system that supports many kinds of services. So, for example, you can model something as a MySQL database, and Disnomia is a plugin that knows how to activate and deactivate a MySQL database. And you can basically use this for any kind of technology, as long as you just implement an activation plugin that has a standardized interface. Also, Disnix Env itself is composed of several command line utilities. So, for example, Disnix Env first builds the configuration, then distributes the configuration, then activates it. They're all implemented by separate command line utilities that you can also invoke yourself if you must. And also, for example, if we enable build delegation, that's what we did with the Windows machine, two additional command line utilities are invoked that are responsible for doing that. So, back to our example system, the staff tracker that we've designed. I want to deploy this with Disnix. So how can we do that? So first, of course, I need to implement it. So I just picked some technologies to implement these components. I use MongoDB for each database. I use Node.js for the web application and services. I provide a REST API for each data set. And I add an Nginx proxy in front of it. So I cheated a bit in my previous example. So I already had three machines available that I pre-deployed myself. But in order to completely perform a deployment process of a system, we also need to create these machines first. And that's, for example, something Disnix doesn't support. Disnix expects machines to be present already, having certain kinds of characteristics. So So some people ask me like, hey, NixOps and Disnix are pretty similar to each other. Are they actually in competition with each other? But they actually serve different purposes. And NixOps can actually solve this infrastructure deployment problem. It can provide me machines running NixOS, having certain characteristics. And I can use Disnix to deploy to these machines. So for example, this machine configuration is enough to get my example system running. I, for example, need MongoDB to be running, and I need the Disnix service. And also, the NixOS module system is quite clever. So if I enable MongoDB, Disnix also gets configured to get the MongoDB plugin for Disnomia running so that I can activate MongoDB databases. Then there's an extension tool for DisNix called DisNixOS, and that's something you can use to basically integrate NixOps and DisNix with each other. So from a user perspective, the major difference between DisNix and DisNixOS is the infrastructure model. The infrastructure model captures the available machines and their properties, but the NixOps specification sort of does the same thing. So DisNixOS allows you to use a NixOps model instead of an infrastructure model, and then simply deploy to whatever we have deployed with NixOps. And that's actually what I intend to show now. So this is the reason why I deployed two NixOps machines. So they have been deployed successfully. But I can now, for example, use DisNix to deploy my Node.js processes in the databases. So with this environment variable, I can specify to which NixOps deployment I want to refer. And by running this command line instruction, so here I provide the NixOps models as a parameter. And I also tell DisNixOS to use NixOps. And by running this, I can get this nice staff tracker example deployed into production. This also should take less than a minute, but yeah, it's now evaluating the network configurations, but that's quite memory consuming. Okay, now it starts building the components, but I pre-built them already, so this should be pretty quick. Okay, now it's distributing the closures of all the components. I think my machine is responding quite slowly because of these virtual machines. Now apparently reading a lot of files. I can see the LED indicator of my hard drive blinking. Ah, okay. Now it's uploading closures. And now it's activating all the service components, like the databases and the node processes, in the right order. So this order is derived from all the interdependencies. And now it's done. I deployed the web application frontend to the first machine. I have to figure out what its IP address is. So this is the IP address of the first machine. So I can simply use my web browser now to open the Stuff Tracker web frontend. Okay. Takes a while before Firefox gets started. Ah, so this is the web application. It doesn't look very exciting, but it should work. So there's one important person from the Nix project missing. That was my former colleague, Rob Vermaas. So let's add him. As you can see, Rob Vermaas has been added. And actually, the insertion in the database is handled by a different microservice that actually resided on machine test 2 instead of test 1. So we have a distributed application running now on two machines deployed by NixOps. Okay, so that was my second demo. So regarding these examples I've shown you, they were kind of silly, right? So I've also been using NixOps and DisNix in practice at my current employer, Conference Compass. So what Conference Compass basically does is they provide a service, and the most visible part of the service is actually their app. They provide apps for conference organizers and attendees, and basically the idea is that each customer gets their own app with their own set of features, their own style, their own artwork, and so on. We have actually set up a Hydra-based product line to accomplish that, but I'm not going to talk about that in this presentation. But also, one of the features we have is we have a web application that each customer can use to configure the app. So, for example, an app needs to display the conference program. And we have a web application allowing people to configure the conference program and dynamically publish that as an update to the app. And also, for some of our big customers, we connect to their information systems because they typically have some means to maintain and program themselves. And we integrate with that so that they don't have to manually provide the data. We made some architectural decisions. So each app requires a configurator. We've decided to deploy many instances of a configurator instead of just having one big configurator that's responsible for handling all the traffic. That has all kinds of advantages. For example, we have no single point of failure. If a configurator for one app crashes, then the other should still run. It's also more scalable in the sense that if one configurator is slow, it shouldn't slow the others down. We can also be more flexible, like moving configurators from one machine to another. We can support multiple versions. So, for example, for an old app, we don't have to be afraid breaking the old app by changing the API of the REST interface. And we also use several programming languages. So, for example, for the configurator, we use Node.js. But we also implement programs that integrate with each third-party service, and we implement it as a separate Python process. And all these components communicate with each other through REST APIs. So in practice, this means we deploy four kinds of services with Disnix. We deploy configurators, channels. We deploy Mongo databases that basically for each configurator instance, we have a separate database. And we deploy Nginx proxies. And we deploy one Nginx proxy per machine that's responsible for handling all the incoming traffic and doing the caching. So this is a very simple deployment scenario. So if we have one machine, the gray box denotes a machine. And each oval is a service. So we have one Nginx proxy that redirects incoming requests to two possible configurators. We have one called CC demo and one called KS. And each configurator instance connects to its own private channel and database. I actually used a tool in the Disnix toolset called Disnix Visualize to generate this picture. We may run into a situation that we suddenly require a lot of network bandwidth. So for example, a Congress goes live, then if we have too many configurators on one machine, we might not be able to handle all the traffic. So we want to move a configurator instance to a second machine. And Disnix actually allows us to do that easily. We can just adapt the distribution model and put a second Nginx service in front of it, and we're done. And also, we can do more advanced stuff. We can also even deploy multiple redundant instances of the same configurator if we really have to handle a lot of network load. And that's also done by simply changing the distribution model, and that's it. So, yeah, but so we've been using Disnix and NixOps for quite a while now, since January. And we've been managing like between 6 and 11 Amazon EC2 instances. That really depends on how much system resources we need at a time. We've deployed over 80 configurators with Disnix. And if you would take all the interdependencies into account, that means we have more than 200 services managed by Disnix. Also, we update the production environment quite a lot. So that means sometimes we even update like 3 times a day. I think some companies, especially enterprises, they're afraid implementing upgrades once a month even. And we can do it 3 times a day. I think that's quite impressive. And also the transition phase duration is 5 minutes. So in the phase in which we deactivate old services and activate services, there is a bit of downtime. But if we would reactivate the entire environment, it would take at most 5 minutes. I think that's also quite nice. So yeah, that's basically my talk. So what I've been trying to explain is the relevance of microservice architectures, or I would rather call them componentized architectures. I've explained how to do service deployment with Disnix. I've also shown that you can integrate that with NixOps to do infrastructure deployment. And I've shown a real-life usage scenario. So yeah, if you want to know more, there's the Disnix homepage, of course. The examples I've used in this presentation, they're also available online. There's one thing I have to remind every one of you. It's still an advanced prototype tool, Disnix, so some things might not be perfect. And also in terms of usability, definitely some things can be improved, but I'm working on that. And of course, there's also my PhD dissertation, so if you really want to know everything, you should read this. Okay, that's it.
Okay, we have time only for one or two questions, but I think Sander will still be around, right? So it's not the last opportunity to ask.
How do you deal with state? You talk about things migrating between machines easily. What if it has something in /var, or what if there's an upgrade to be done, or stuff like that?
Yeah, that's actually a very good question. I left these details out of the presentation because otherwise it would become much too long. But recently I implemented an extension to Dysnomia, the tool that implements the activation and deactivation operations, also to have snapshot and restore operations. By default, it's disabled because it's still quite experimental, but you can also enable it by annotating the services in the services model, like, hey, this has state, please migrate it for me. And what it does is basically it consults the snapshot operation of Dysnomia, transfers the snapshot to the host machine, and then after the upgrade has been done, it transfers it to the new machines and restores the snapshots accordingly. So there's a pluggable snapshot and restore framework that can be used for that. But it's not always the best solution, by the way, to use it. Because, for example, if you would move a MySQL database to one machine or another, it calls MySQL dump. And for MongoDB, it calls Mongo dump. But serializing a database into a portable format and back again is quite an expensive operation. So using replication engines, for example, for big data sets would be much more a much better fit for the, but for small data sets, it's actually fine. So at my current employer, we have databases that are like 20 or 30 megabytes in size, and you could easily move them around with Mongo dump and Mongo restore. And that's actually what we've been using to move data around, and that actually works quite well for us.
Hi, I wanted to know, how does this system, from a distributed systems point of view, how does your coordinator handle partial failure and reconciliation in the face of partial failure?
You mean if any of the activities fail while deploying a system? What happens?
Yeah, transient network failures, machines die. What kind of resiliency does this system have to this production environment?
Disnix, if you deploy a system with Disnix, it's actually, I can show you the slide. So if I would decompose Disnix env, these tools are executed. The first two tools on top, the first one builds the configuration. It produces some kind of low-level specification called a manifest. That's always safe to execute because it uses Nix as the underlying infrastructure to build it. And you, if, for example, a build fails in the middle, it's considered garbage by Nix, and it gets removed if you run the garbage collector, for instance. So that's always a safe operation. Same thing for distribute. So if copying a closure interrupts in the middle, that means you have a set of valid packages and then a set of invalid packages. The set of valid packages always has never has any broken relationship dependency relationships, for example. So that's also safe. But the other activities like activating and setting the profiles, that's actually unsafe. So one of the things I, for example, do is I lock the Disnix service instances on the target machine so that others cannot interfere with it. But if for some reason the network connection fails, then the host machine still knows, hey, I'm not done yet because I don't have configured this, the Disnix profiles on the machines yet. So that means I probably have to redo the whole activation procedure from scratch. But still, it's there are still some improvements possible, because it could also happen that a machine disappears while deploying, but it never comes back again. And that means, yeah, you have to change the distribution model probably to...
Yeah, as a follow-up, so would you consider Disnix like a deployment tool or a cluster manager?
Like Disnix itself is a deployment tool, and and the reason why I consider it to be a deployment tool is that the specifications, the services model, the infrastructure model, and distribution model, they're only used for carrying out the corresponding deployment activities. You might also want to think about other aspects while deploying a system. For example, in the distribution model, you have to be quite explicit about the mapping. So you have to really say, I want this service to be deployed to machine test 2. But if you have a an environment with like 1,000 machines, that's too tedious probably. So you want to have something that says, figure out a machine with enough system resources that can run it.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, Disnix doesn't support that directly, but I also implemented, while I was doing research on my PhD thesis, an extension framework called Dynamic Disnix. And there you can use deployment planning algorithms to calculate distributions, for example. And also you can retrieve machine configuration settings by a discovery service. So there's less for you to write. But that's still experimental. It's actually still my list to make it more mature, but I'm still working on that. But the core tool set that actually carries out the activities, so the basic Disnix tool set, that should be mature enough. But this extension tool set, that's, yeah, the only reference used to, at the moment is my research paper or my PhD thesis, if you want to know more.
All right, we've run out of time, unfortunately. So thank you very much.